Let's have a beer and play with some pens. This beer is called a Longboard Island Lager made by Kona Brewing Company. It's a smooth beer, and I like it okay. And now let's take a trip back into the 1920s. This is a Parker Duofold Jr. This particular pen was made in about 1926, I believe. This particular pen was my grandfather's. And in this video, I thought I would ink it up and give it a try. I'm going to use this thin piece of stainless steel, and I'm going to do what you call flossing the tines. Basically, I'm just going to drag this thin piece of metal through the slit that is in the nib, just to ensure that it is cleaned out. Some people think you should use a piece of brass rather than stainless steel. And I agree, but this is what I had just kind of lying around. And people think you should use brass so that you don't damage the nib. This nib on this pen is solid gold. I'm going to use this micrometer to measure the thickness of this piece of stainless steel. This micrometer was made in the 1920s. And this micrometer also belonged to my grandfather. It's a Model 13 made by Brown and Sharp. And this piece of stainless steel is 1/1000th of an inch thick. I have on hand a thicker piece of stainless steel. Let's measure this. And this one is a 1.5 thousandths of an inch thick. To give you an idea of this measurement, a piece of paper is typically about 5 thousandths of an inch thick. And a human hair is usually around 2 to 4 thousandths of an inch thick. And this third piece of stainless steel is 2 thousandths of an inch. Now the nib on this pen, I can tell right away, needs adjustment. Because if it was adjusted properly, the 1 thousandth piece of stainless steel should have slid through the slit in the nib without much trouble, but it was kind of tight. And this piece of 1.5 thousandths is even a tighter fit than the other. The 1 thousandth should have went through with very light friction, but it was rather tight. So I know the nib needs adjustment. And quite frankly, I do not expect it to write very well. My grandfather used this measuring tool for many decades, working at Parker Pen as a tool and die maker. And there's my dog scratching at the door. Now this ink right here is Noodler's Apache. It's a very pleasing color of orange. And I hope it matches the pen's color. And that's not too bad, but it seems kind of dark. You can't see it, but I'm actually depressing the button that was at the end of the pen underneath the small black cap. And it's basically a plunger, and I depressed it and slowly released it about 3 times. let's put the cap back on. And let's put this cap back on. And let's test it on this Clairefontaine spiral notebook paper. Yeah, I already do not like this. It's very dry. And that would be indicative of the slit on the nib being closed up like I was talking about. Yeah, the gap is just not wide enough to provide a proper flow of ink. Parker made a larger version of this pen that was just simply known as the Duofold. And like I mentioned earlier in this video, this is the Parker Duofold Jr. The dry nib produces a very scratchy sound that may not be very pleasing to listen to. It kind of reminds me of fingernails on a chalkboard. And right away, that brings to mind the scene from Jaws, you know, the movie from the 70s about the shark. The shark bounty hunter, I forget his name, in that scene where he was trying to get the attention of the city council and pulled his fingers across the chalkboard. It definitely got everybody's attention. Now, the scope of this video is not to adjust the nib. I'll do that at a later time. I just wanted to try this pen out and maybe talk about the decade of the 1920s, which many of you know had a nickname. The nickname was the Roaring Twenties. There's an awful lot happened in that decade. Now this is a mechanical pencil that matches, it goes with this pen. It's a matching set. This is the Parker Duofold Jr. mechanical pencil. So obviously this was also manufactured in the mid-20s. And it writes as well as any pencil. And this too belonged to my grandfather. Now my grandfather was a tool and die maker for Parker Pen. And he went to work for Parker Pen in the 1920s. And having access to materials and machinery, he also came up with a nifty little item to hold the pencil lead for his mechanical pencil. It's this little tube. It's made out of the same material as the pen and the pencil. Now, my grandfather was a pretty smart man and was always inventing things. And this pencil lead holding tube may be the only one, as far as I know, in existence, because it was, as far as I know, it was something he made, is what I was told. If I'm wrong on that, someone please tell me. When it comes to family history, sometimes all you know is what you're told by others. Now, this is not the same pen. It looks a lot like it, but it's about the size of a normal size Duofold. My Duofold Park fountain pen is the junior model, like I mentioned, which is smaller. Now this particular pen holds a secret, and here it is. It's a ballpoint. I know a lot of you just took a big gasp. But I do use ballpoints. Now, in the 1970s, and that's when the pen on top was made, there was a lot of nostalgia in America for the 1920s. And so Parker made a ballpoint pen to as one writer said, ride a wave of nostalgia. Now this is a modern Parker gel refill that I put into the pen, because when I do use ballpoints, I can't stand a standard pen refill. I have to use the gel ink, because it writes much better. In this particular pen, I use this ballpoint almost on a daily basis. When it's in the rotation, I use it on a daily basis, as long as it's in the rotation. And what I mean by that is I have a handful of pens that I'll use one for 2 or 3 weeks, and then I'll start using another. Now, this is a rather large pen, and I believe it's a 1972 model. And the series name, or the model of this ballpoint pen, is called the Parker Big Red. Now, Parker came out with the Big Red in, I believe, 1972. And they continued to make the pen until about 1980, 81, 82, somewhere around there. Now, because of the gel refill that this pen sports, it's like most gel refills, it's like riding on ice. I mean, it just slips around all over the place. It's very smooth. But unlike a fountain pen, there's no feedback. So it takes a very large amount of control to keep from sliding right off the road into a ditch when you use this pen. But having said that, I still enjoy writing with this pen, I guess because of the nostalgia of it. So I guess Parker knew what they were doing when they made a nostalgic copy of what might be one of the most famous fountain pens in history, the Parker Duofold. When I was a kid, an aunt and uncle gave me one of these Parker Big Red ballpoint pens with a yellow body and a green cap. And engraved in the body was Packer Backer, and it had my name on it. And obviously the colors were for the Green Bay Packers. I wished I knew what became of that pen. So if you're watching this video and you have my pen, enjoy. So those three items on the left are from the 1920s. And the big red on the right is from 1972. Now here's another Parker Big Red. This one's still in a box. And in 1972, when you bought this pen, this is the packaging that it came in. Here's the little owner's pamphlet that came with the pen. As you can see, there's a couple on it that are dancing. What they're doing is the Charleston, which is a popular dance back in the 1920s. And this is a copy of a Time Life magazine cover from the 20s. And as you can tell, Parker basically, with permission I'm sure, copied this magazine cover from the 1920s. And the lady dancing on the left, she has a necklace flying in the air. And on the Parker pamphlet, there's a necklace flying in the air, but on the end of the necklace is a Parker ring top. Big Red, which was a ladies' version of this pen. And this shows the different parts. Yeah, you can see the ring top, Big Red, on the end of the necklace. The ring top was just a ring for the necklace to attach to. Now this pen doesn't have a logo on it like the other one. The other one you noticed had the logo of a steel company on it called CF&I. steel company. And this pen not having a logo and still in the original box makes me not want to use it. As a matter of fact, this pen has the original ink refill in it. What the? Well, that's not good. Yeah, you can tell it's the original refill. From 30 something years ago. It's leaking. Interestingly enough, though, what it's leaking is not blue. These Parker Big Reds were modeled after the streamlined version of the Parker Duofold fountain pen. And my little Duofold Jr. is not one of the streamlined versions. And here's the blue ink that Parker put in this pen many decades ago. And even though 1972 was a rather long time ago, it's not near as long as the 1920s. Back in the 1920s, for the first time, more Americans lived in cities rather on farms. And women were allowed to vote for the first time in 1920 or 21, I think, thanks to the 19th Amendment to the Constitution. Change it to grams. 17 grams. 16 grams. And that's more like it. And also in the 1920s, the nation's total wealth more than doubled. And it was this economic growth that swept many Americans into a affluent society. So yeah, back then Americans, well, they had extra money to spend. Some of the things that they bought were, believe it or not, ready-to-wear clothing. And home appliances like electric refrigerators and radios, lots of radios. As a matter of fact, the first commercial radio station in the United States was Pittsburgh's KDKA, which hit the airways in 1920. And radios were so popular that within 3 years of the first radio station, KDKA, was, within 3 years, there were 500 stations across the nation. And thanks to radio and phonograph records, a new genre of music called jazz took hold of the nation. Musicians like Duke Ellington and Al Jolson were big names during that time. And like I mentioned earlier, dancing, especially the Charleston, was a big pastime. What do you say we ink up this inexpensive Chinese fountain pen? This pen is made by, I think it's pronounced Baoer. It's spelled B-A-O-E-R. This pen only cost about $5. It's got this little plastic ball glass. Maybe it's glass. You can see it in the converter. Here's the Noodler's Apache. The same ink that we put in the Parker Duofold. But let's take a look at this Noodler's Dragon's Napalm. This color may be a better fit for this pen. That's pretty nice. So I think we'll go ahead and use the Dragon's Napalm. I generally don't match the ink to the color of the pen, but in this video I am, and I think the Dragon's Napalm is that looks like a better match. So let's say goodbye to the Noodler's Apache. Exit stage right. And let's say hello to the dragon. And I'm going to aim this upward, and I'm going to turn the converter and force some of the air out. There was just a little pocket of air. I'll force that out, and then I'll re-dip the pen and pull up just a little bit more ink. I wanted to get all of the ink that I could into this pen. I'm gonna use this pen for, I don't know, probably about a month. So it's gonna be going into my pocket for regular use. You know, that was a pretty good beer. And that's where I stop. On occasion, I may have two beers if I'm at home. That writes pretty good. It's not near as dry writing as the Parker Duofold Jr. that I showed you earlier. But a minute ago I was talking about everybody buying radios in the 1920s. because by the end of the 1920s, there were more than 12 million let me rephrase that. More than 12 million households had radios. And of course, with radio comes radio advertising. And thanks to this advertising, people from coast to coast bought the same goods for the first time and listened to the same music. They did the same dances, like the Charleston. And they even used the same slang in their language for the first time, coast to coast, all because of radio. Let's do a little bit of doodling, and we'll continue to talk about the 1920s. Let's draw a kind of a stuffy looking, history professor. Now he could tell you about the 20s probably. And how Americans bought a lot of automobiles in the 20s. Okay, Model T Ford cost about $260 in 1924. And by the end of the decade, thanks to free-flowing credit, and there was a car on the road for every 5 Americans. But now that you had all of these cars on the road, along with that came the automobile industry. Meaning industries that met the needs of motorists, such as service stations and the hundreds of motels that sprang up across the nation. Oh, and movies. You know, movies had been pretty much a silent affair until the 1920s, but in the last part of the decade, movies finally had soundtracks. And Americans weren't used to that. And, you know, soundtracks, I mean, that was novel stuff. So Americans went to the movies in record numbers. And about 75% of Americans visited a movie theater pretty much every week, now that the movies were no longer silent. And now that World War I was over, in the 1920s, there was a housing boom. And of course, that led to a huge increase in home ownership. People were moving into the cities, away from the farms. And let's draw a little farm girl. I won't say draw, I should say doodle. Let's doodle, because it's... I'm not an artist. I just doodle. And the things that I draw are just crude, simple little things. And also in the 20s, as a matter of fact, 1920, you had the Volstead Act, which most of you, well, yeah, I'll say most of you probably studied this, so you should know that that was the National Prohibition Act. And of course, Prohibition led to an increase in the black market alcohol sales. And of course, the mob, the gangsters. I mean, the mob back then was a lot different than the mob today. The word gangster back then had a totally different meaning than it does now. But the mob, they got into the black market alcohol and sold it in these things they called speakeasies. Which were basically places that you could go and have a drink. Pretty much like a bar. Except they were kind of short on entertainment. It was just a place to go and drink, pretty much. We have the history teacher. Now let's draw his wife. In 1924, Macy's held their first Thanksgiving Day parade. And also in 24, Ellis Island closed. It was no longer used as a immigration entry point into the United States. And at that time, Sears and Roebuck opened its first retail store in Chicago in 1925. They'd been selling their items through home shopping catalogs for a long time, since the late 1800s. mean, they continued to do so, but now they had a store you could walk into. And this became one of the largest chain stores in the country. The year after that, Ford, you know, the people that made the Model T, well, they came out with this thing called the 40-hour work week. So everyone that works a 40-hour week now, I guess you can thank Henry Ford for that. And in 1927, the Holland Tunnel opened under the Hudson River, connecting New York City with Jersey. Also in 27, Charles Lindbergh flew his airplane called the Spirit of St. Louis across the Atlantic Ocean. And it was the first solo transatlantic flight. Then they also began work on Mount Rushmore during the 1920s. You know, the mountain with the faces in it, George Washington and Thomas Jefferson, Theodore Roosevelt and Abraham Lincoln. You know, it took them 15 years to complete that once they began. And in 1928, there was an Englishman named Alexander Fleming that made a huge discovery. It was penicillin. It changed the world of modern medicine and introduced us to the age of antibiotics. And of course, at the end of the decade, in 1929, the stock market crashed. Well, that was the end of all the good times and ushered us into the Great Depression. And during the 20s, women became sort of rebellious, a lot of them, and started wearing clothes that were very comfortable and no longer accentuated the feminine attributes, so to speak. They wore hairstyles that were short and easy to keep. I think they called them the bob. And they did this pretty much as a statement of who they are, who they were. And this style of dress and the way they acted, they pretty much partied a lot. And they weren't shy. But these women were called flappers. In the picture that I showed you, the Time Life magazine cover had one of those ladies on it. And the Parker pamphlet had a flapper on it also. In men's style of clothing became less stuffy, and the men tried to look more youthful. Yeah, the 20s were the time for some pretty radical changes. And I'm not sure that I would have wanted to live in the 20s. Well, my glass is empty and the video's over. And I hope you enjoyed it.